In the following demonstration, we will look at the ability of Krakatoa to be used as a non-photorealistic renderer. Let's start again with a Stanford Bunny mesh, convert it to PRT volume, and uncheck the disable subdivisions option and check the subdivide region to produce a little bit more particles. We could also enable the sit in surface shell option and set the shell to somewhere around 0 to 10. This gives us a thickness of particles along the surface of 10 units and no particles in the core of the object. In the viewport, the particles are never illuminated, they are just drawn as points with the color from the color channel of the particle system. A way to get a better idea of the 3D volume of the object would be to add the Krakatoa channels modifier and switch the input to normal channel. This provides a kind of red, green, blue shading that looks like illumination. But an even better approach would be to calculate Lambert shading by taking the dot product of the normal vector at each point and a unit vector defining the direction of the light. And since the dot product produces a floating point number, we could multiply a vector with the color of our choice by the dot product in order to produce black in the shadow areas and the value of the color in the light areas. It would be a good idea to actually normalize the vector defining the light direction. And if you would start changing the value of the vector defining the light direction, the light on the object will also shift. An even better approach would be to actually calculate the lighting direction from a position defined by a scene object. Let's take a point helper and assume that this is the position of our light and subtract the position of the point helper and the position of the particles. In this case, if we would start to move the helper in the scene, it will serve as the position of an omnilight, and the shading will be calculated by our magma flow according to the world position of this point. An important thing to keep in mind is that the positions of the particles are in object space and not in world space, so if we would rotate our bunny, the lighting wouldn't be calculated correctly. In order to get it right, we would have to transform the vector defining the position in world space from world space to object space. And now, if we would rotate the bunny, the lighting will be calculated correctly. Similarly, moving the bunny around would also correctly shift the lighting. Currently, the color of the lighting is being defined by a single vector. Obviously, changing this value will change also the color of the light, but the shadow always remains black. This is because we're multiplying a vector by a floating point number that ranges between minus 1 and plus 1. In fact, the shadow is currently a vector multiplied by a negative number, so it's a good idea to introduce a function clamp and by holding control and pressing 0 and 1, define the range between 0 and 1, so any negative values will be clamped at 0. Now the shadow is actually a vector multiplied by 0. And we could switch the multiply operator to a function blend, hold control, shift, and press W to connect the control input to the third slot. This is the dot product, which will define whether the first, the second, or blend of the two vectors will be used, and we'll create another vector to define the light color. We can press Ctrl W to swap the first and second inputs, and we can now use these two vectors to define a true color setup, where the one vector defines the shadow area and the other vector defines the light area. Obviously, moving the light source around will correctly illuminate our bunny. Yet another way to control the shading in the viewport would be to switch the blend operator to conversion operation type to vector, and then remove the two vectors and connect the clamp value to the x, y, and z of the two vector operator. This initially produces a grayscale, black and white shading on the bunny, because we're using a floating point number between 0 and 1 to convert to a vector where the R, G, and B will have the same value each time. But we can also switch the output to texture code. This produces UV coordinates in channel 1 with a value between 0 and 1 for U, V, and W as the lighting changes across the surface. So if we would assign a standard material to our particle object and then provide a gradient ramp as the color source for the diffuse channel, updating will actually produce shading based on the gradient ramp. This gives us a lot of flexibility to define the transition between colors. And not only this, we could switch the interpolation to solid, introduce some more flags, and define the shadow area as one color, then the transitions between the different shading areas as brighter shades of blue and the highlight color almost white. If we would update now, we actually get a kind of cartoon shading with a paint that has only four different shading values. Let's assign Krakatoa as the current renderer and take a look at the output of this setup. As you probably remember from previous tutorials, if we would hit render now, since there is no light source in the scene and no emission is enabled, the particles, the 3.3 million particles that we generated, will render black in the viewport and create a solid alpha channel. Let's enable the use emission, and in order to get the color that we see in the viewport into the emission channel, we'll create a global override set, and the Krakatoa channel's modifier there will output the color defined in the viewport as the emission color. So if we would render now, the emission channel will be set to the color of the color channel. In version 1.6, we also have to make sure that the emission strength has about the same value as the density for the final path. This looks much closer to what we see in the viewport, and we could also enable the override background color option and set the background color to some shade of blue in order to provide a paper background for our cartoon shading. Now that we have the paint of our cartoon shading, let's take a look at a possible way to provide an ink outline. If we would look at the gradient ramp in the material editor, the current gradient type is set to linear. We could switch it to normal, and rendering this way will take the normals in camera space and shade the outside of the object with the darker color and the inside with the brighter one, while ignoring the light completely. We can use this fact to provide an outline ink by setting up another gradient ramp. Let's call it ink, switching to normal mode and solid interpolation, and setting it to black and white, where black will define the thickness of the outline, and the white will multiply with the paint color and produce exactly the same look as now. In order to apply this ink, we're going to edit the global override for the emission. We'll multiply the color coming from the color channel by a map containing the ink gradient ramp. And if we would render now, we'll get a black outline wherever the gradient is producing black, and the white color multiplied by the original color will produce the original color for the painting. We could select our bunny and change slightly the view angle in order to see how this shading looks from different angles. Unfortunately, the viewport can't represent the colors from the global overrides. The global overrides are applied only at render time. Another thing that we could do in order to control the actual color being used for the outline would be to remove the multiply operator and use the map to control a blend operator, function blend, where the map will be connected to the blend ratio, and in order to work there, it has to be switched from color to mono, which is a floating point input expected for the control of a blend. And we'll also provide a second vector, which will be the color used for the outline. Green is probably not the best color for an outline, but we can dial in some form of blue-violet color, for example. And since black will output the first slot, we'll have to press Ctrl W to swap the two inputs. So the color for the outline will be piped into the first slot and the original color into the second. If we render now, the outline will have the color defined by the first input. Let's try something more extreme, for example, red, and then hit the render button again. Obviously, we can control the thickness of the outline by changing the flag in the second gradient. Let's make it even thicker. As you can see, we can use magma flow and Krakatoa as a kind of non-photorealistic renderer to produce effects like cartoon shading and Lambert shading in the viewports and at render time.